Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, episode 528. That's a lot of Tuesdays. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here live in Mayhem Studio in Pittsburgh, PA. We're ready to talk professional wrestling with you guys and with a great crew from all over the place. First of all, coming at us from San Antonio, Texas. I almost said Poughkeepsie, Texas. That was really weird.
Small, unknown town of Poughkeepsie, Texas.
Poughkeepsie, Texas. Eamon Payton, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling down there. How you doing, man?
Hi, I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to not be from Poughkeepsie, Texas, because that sounds like a very sad place. But I'm excited to be on the show this week.
And also with us from Johnstown, PA, Floodtown, USA, it is Bobby FJ Town.
I am surrounded by toys.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
In various shapes.
On various walls.
On various walls, yes.
And also, we have a very special guest joining us for a little bit of analysis to help us out as we're leading into some pretty big events this year or this week with the Cruiserweight Classic and a few other things. So we thought it was a good time to have back on our good friend, Joe Dombrowski, with us, joe-dombrowski.com, voice of I don't even know how many promotions these days. You are all over the place. Your itinerary I've been seeing on the Twitter and the Facebook has been crazy. I can't even keep up with you, Joe, but I know you're currently in the Pittsburgh area.
I am currently located in the Pittsburgh area, yeah. It's been a whirlwind just this week. I was in Spencer, West Virginia on Saturday night, where I had a very nerve-wracking physical altercation with the Barbarian. Came home and did some voiceover work for NWA Mid-South and their recent event down in Morgan City, Louisiana. I have voiceover projects to finish this week from Big Time Wrestling events in Altoona, Pennsylvania, and Danbury, Connecticut, and also another new pay-per-view for Wrestling's Bloodiest Wars. So I am literally in multiple places at once.
Wow, he is everywhere. Thank you so much for taking the time out to join us, of course. Like I said, this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. You can join us and find out about everything else going on at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to this show, many other shows as well. Indie Mayhem Show is going to be returning next week. I believe we have on the docket our friends from AIW, Absolute Intense Wrestling, going to be joining us on there. And other things like the Midweek War, Raw Wrap-Up. Eddie can join us, Wrestling Mayhem Show, on the Facebook group, at Mayhem Show on Twitter, and watch a lot of the shows there. YouTube as well, a lot of things like the wrap-ups and the watch parties the guys have been doing, including the one on the Final Deletion, which will be something that we talk about today a little bit. You can also drop us a line to the phone number, the hotline. Let us hear your voice. And I'm sorry, because I sometimes can't hear what your name is. What was that last guy, like Tim Tiger or something I named him? 412-206-WMS0. We do love to hear from you, regardless. We do mess up your name. Also, you can drop us a line to goodtimes@wrestlingmayhemshow.com.
Good times.
Hey, I messed up the timing. I'm sorry.
I got worried because you kept it. I was like,
you skipped it.
Like, I skipped it. It's all right. I was keeping you on your toes. And drop us a line there. Let us know what you think about what's going on in wrestling, about stuff that we've talked about in wrestling. Do you hate our picks for the WWE or the Mayhem Draft that we've been doing the last several weeks? Which reminds me, I think I need to make some picks for this evening's draft. So I'll be working on that violently during the show. Violently, that's the wrong word.
Violently.
I'm not the worst.
Maybe you shouldn't go to the gathering, the Juggalos.
if you're gonna be that violent in a fantasy draft, then, guys,
we should. Wait till when we come back with the Indie Mayhem Show. I'm going to tell you about what I'm excited for with the gathering of the Juggalos. So I was looking at, I didn't even realize some of the stuff that was happening until I looked at the schedule last week. And I'm looking forward to that. Anyways, and also thank you to our Patreon supporters, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. You guys, being a part of that means, we'll be trying to get Fleshlight as a sponsor or weird crap like that anymore. So the more of that stuff happens, the less weird happens on the show. Or maybe you want that to happen. Or maybe you can submit to us on the Patreon. Submit
Phrasing.
Money to us on the Patreon at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Thank you to our good friends. Of course, long time. I think the first patron of the show, Antonio Garza of the wrestlingrevolution.com. Our friend, Bo Diggity. Woo. And of course, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Ed Burke, and Alex Cars, all supporters of the show. You can too, as little as a penny, and we appreciate it. If you don't have to give us money for the show, but if you're entertained by it and want to help see it grow, we do appreciate if you do, or if just share the show, tell a friend about it, or give us some feedback on any of those social media platforms or contacts that we just talked about. Let's talk about wrestling in some aspect. Of course, like I said, we're going to talk about the Cruiserweight Classic here in the second segment, but first, there was a lot of outdoor wrestling that was on our TVs. You and Matt Carlins and Matt and Mike talked extensively, of course, about the Final Deletion with Matt Hardy and Jeff Hardy, for those that don't know about that.
It's Brother Nero.
Brother Nero.
So you know.
Brother
and
Nero.
It's Broken Matt. So, yeah.
Broken Matt and Brother Nero. Okay. So. And seemingly the timing is suspect, but we also had this fight on Monday Night Raw, and I know it's not fair to compare them, but the internet will, so they kind of do get lumped together because they have happened in this last week, and I think it is fair to compare at least in some aspects of this. The New Day of
Bobby shakes his head.
No, Bobby. No comparison. So first of all, I'm very interested because I think, Joe, you said that you have watched the Final Deletion. Of course, this was the interesting segment they did on Impact, and there was a lot of talk going into it.
There was a lot of praise.
A lot of praise. Okay, and I've watched it three times myself. I made my wife watch it. She wasn't as appreciative of it, of course. Joe, what did you think?
You know, it's funny you say that because that is a segment that I want to watch again because so much was going on and it was so unique and so out of the box. But really interesting to see how polarizing that segment was. There were several people vehemently defending it, from fan to people high up in the business, from Chris Jericho and Mick Foley. And there were a lot of people very vehemently detractors toward it. Obviously, the goal was buzz. The goal was attention. And it worked. You can't say it didn't work. TNA posted their highest ratings in nearly 14 months.
Wow.
Obviously, the big question now is, can they follow up and can they capitalize and retain a lot of that audience in the few weeks that follow. Matt Hardy's one of the smartest guys that I have encountered in wrestling. And he's a guy that really gets how to get attention and get people talking about him. And I don't think that anything we saw in the Final Deletion, whether it be just completely over the top or off the wall or camp or whatever descriptor you want to put to it, I don't think any reaction or emotion we felt was accidental or inadvertent. I think Matt and Jeff and Jeremy Borash and anybody else who was a part of making this a reality certainly knew what they were bringing to the table. And parts of it felt almost cinematic. Parts of it felt like an homage to the old White Castle of Fear with Vader and Sting back in the day. But I don't think it is really worthwhile to nitpick the segment as far as, well, this part was cool, but this part was kind of hokey. I think if you look at it in the broad strokes, you can see that it was something different. It wasn't everybody's cup of tea, but everybody left with an opinion about it. And that was the objective. And in that sense, they accomplished it.
Of course. And I know, Eamon, you were one of the... I'd say it's safe to say you're a detractor of this from what I was hearing on the shows last week.
I don't want to call myself a detractor. I agree with Joe in the sense that they achieved everything they wanted to achieve out of it. Like they pulled their highest ratings. They got 80,000 extra viewers to watch their show, and that's great because that's something TNA, I think, desperately needs and has needed for a while now. So no matter what I think about it, you know, kudos to them for that. I don't know. I think it's coupled with the story in general. And I think it was coupled with the original kind of thing that got them a bit of buzz, which was the original contract signing that they did with Jeff and Matt in their home and stuff like that, and the buzz that got. And call it, you know, hipsterish or you know, looking at it that way or whatever. But I think I don't know. I couldn't enjoy the Final Deletion as much as I maybe wanted to, because to me, I just could kind of see the hand that they were trying to play. I think one of the cool parts of the contract signing was the fact that a lot of people didn't know if they were doing this intentionally, if they, you know, thought they were making something that was intentionally supposed to be serious and it came off very corny. And I think that those kind of style of segments and those kind of, a lot of people compared it to like a movie like The Room, for example. And I think the appeal to something like that is the fact that it's a group of people who, for all intents and purposes, for all we know, intended to make something good, and this was the result. And for me, I just couldn't enjoy the Final Deletion from the fact that I really just got the sense that they were definitely playing into that, well, this got us a bit of attention, so let's just keep doing this more. And amplify it. That's what allowed me to not really enjoy it personally. But like I said, who's for me to say? They got 80,000 viewers. So yeah.
And for me, because I haven't been on those shows, but I've been talking a little bit on Twitter as I watched it all three times. But once by itself, and kind of as I was working on stuff, so maybe I missed some stuff. Once again, with you guys on the wrap up, not the wrap up, the watch party you guys did on our YouTube, talking, you know, kind of beside it. And then once again with my wife, as a video producer, I admire some things that they did there. Okay. Like some of, like it was something different than it's a match in the ring with commentators and everything happens with a setting with people watching. Right. And I know we get a little bit of that with like Lucha Underground, but there's still like Lucha Underground has, well, this stuff happens in the temple with people around. Then the other weird stuff happens over here in the back in these segments and who knows where. Right. So there's like a separation there. So I, like I said, I just kind of appreciated some of the storytelling and I took the corniness as meant to be corny, right?
Right.
You guys were commenting on how Revy Sky really has a future as a telenovela. That was Italian. I don't know. But then that kind of thing. I really appreciated that. Just like stuff, like little kind of nods, like winks, I felt like they did through the entire thing. Like this was like, you felt like Jeff and Matt worked this out over the campfire over a long time, and
over a lot of drugs,
and then a lot maybe man
allegedly
maybe man like the most interesting booking ideas I've heard over Denny's, you know, with, you know, people. And you know, and I don't know,
that's
Joe.
Not the same thing as drugs necessarily.
No, not necessarily. And Joe, you're a booker in some fashion over the years, yes, one way or another. And you know, I mean,
felt like a backhanded compliment. You've booked things, sort of.
You're a booker, you know. I don't know if you. I just didn't know if I should say, well, you're a booker, you know, because you're not currently that I'm aware of. But you did for Prime Wrestling, of course, and some other spots over the years.
Well, I mean, it never leaves your blood, and you always look at things with a booker mentality. Sure.
Right. So if you had Matt and Jeff Hardy on your roster in Prime Wrestling, and they came to you for this idea, your reaction would be,
wow. honestly, I would need to be sold on it just because it's so out of the box and something that I wouldn't be able to really wrap my head around in just a verbal pitch. Mm-hmm. I would really need to get the big picture. And that's one thing I always stress if I'm booking something or working with talent or consulting somebody. It's you have to look at the big picture. And certainly seeing where the Broken Matt persona and the Brother Nero persona had gone with the contract signing and with the crazy gimmick matches and with the reference to their past, it makes a little more sense in context. But knowing that Matt marches to the beat of his own drum and thinks outside the box from a lot of other wrestlers, and Jeff is just completely out there with how he expresses himself, I guess I wouldn't be surprised, but I would need I'd need a really thorough layout and probably a tentative budget to figure it out. But from what I've heard, that was shot at a very tight budget, and they got a lot out of a little. So kudos to them for that too.
I was gonna say there was a lot of attention. This isn't like they had like Rebby in the back, with a handy cam like filming this thing pure backyard style. Like they had like it looks like they had jib cranes and I was trying to figure out if it was a crane or a drone in some of those shots. Probably. You know, I mean that.
Well, even just the setting shots, through the fields and through the estate, both for this and for that contract sign, just that brought a different kind of feel to it, and it seemed very big league. So there was a lot of effort put into this all around.
There was at least a high end, like I had the feeling like there was like a reality show video crew on this. You know what I mean? Like it had that kind of vibe, that vibe to it that I felt like I'd seen before. So guys, it could have been more. As much as that was great or bad, whatever your opinion, it could have been more.
It could have been more. Did they hit up Radio Shack before to get all the drones that were on clearance?
That was great, especially the ones like how many shots of him taking a swing at the one in his living room. it was so great.
Just like went through drones like it's nothing.
Just so great.
About 40 pack at Sam's Club.
Almost to that point though, having a conversation with our friend of the show, he's been on here several times, Chris LaRusso, and he was on a show actually this weekend where both Matt and Jeff. We're on a Northeast Wrestling, I think it is, NEW, the one I worked with last year up in Niles at the ball field up there in Niles, Ohio. And he's telling me about first of all, as far as like maybe the long term, Joe, as you were discussing, they were there. First of all, our friend Scooch had a great picture I posted over on the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook of him as the Wyatts, as Bray Wyatt in a picture with Matt. And Matt actually wanted to take a separate picture alone with him to do the poses. So that was cool. He's playing into it. And especially after, what we just saw with the Wyatts the other night, which we'll touch on. But he says, by the way, people are bringing Matt xylophones and drones and stuff to sign at the ballpark show. Like, awesome. Also, he came out apparently in full Broken Matt character, I guess. And he brought out King Booker. In character, okay. As King Booker. So apparently it was a pretty fun show. But he also
couple of very proficient and prolific accents.
Oh, questionable accents all around, just on display for all at this show. But there was some other tidbits that, and I don't think he's the only one that's been hearing this, of course. But basically, supposedly the segment was supposed to go longer. For instance, there was going to be a brawl on the boat. It was going to be longer. Willow was going to be like Jason Voorhees pulling Matt out of the boat was one thing that they did not accomplish. And there was a thing where they went into the water and he kind of Willow rose up and everything. I know you guys were saying how you lost it whenever that happened or whenever the mask got pulled off and it was the gardener and stuff. The more I look at this, the more I'm impressed by this and what they did. I think I've stated like I want Matt and Jeff to get a show on WWE Network where they just do this kind of stuff. Like that, this is their version
like
of the Edge
and Christian.
Yeah, like the Edge and Christian show, except we just send a video crew to Cameron, North Carolina in their backyard, and the Matt and Jeff like saga plays out like this. You know what I mean?
I just want to watch Jeff talking about his Illuminamis.
Exactly.
Like forever.
But anyways, well, from that, and again, people are drawing comparisons because we also saw last night the Wyatts, was at the Wyatt compound, I think they said, taking on the New Day, which is just, I didn't like it. we talked about
you talked about this last night
on the Raw wrap up, but I initially, and again, I think I need to rewatch it. I think I certainly need to rewatch it. Mm-hmm. I had trouble following it. I thought there was too atmospheric. I thought there was too much to it. I which is funny watching the Final Deletion, right? It wasn't bad, but I don't know if I enjoyed it as much as I should have in this case.
I don't know. I really enjoyed this. Mm-hmm. I think this style.
I'm apparently in the minority, by the way, from what I'm hearing.
Well, so. I think no, I disagree because I think the Wyatt compound stuff is a bit more split as far as people's opinions are, as opposed to the Final Deletion, where I saw like a good 95% of it was positive, at least from what I saw. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. For me, especially with the story they've been doing with the Wyatts and the New Day, I think it benefited both groups very well. And I think it also, like I said, is something that we've been wanting from the Wyatt family for a long time. And it's because usually the Wyatt family is kind of, for the last like year or year and a half or so, have just kind of been guys with this gimmick who wrestle. You know what I mean? I like the idea of them doing something that really does play into their characters. And I really enjoyed it just because I think in the overall scheme of things, I think it worked for what they're trying to deliver with the storyline. And to me, I think that's pretty essential. And to me, that's probably why I wasn't a huge fan of the Final Deletion. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think overall, I really, really did enjoy what they put forward. And then of course, like you said before, people are going to compare the two. But I don't think they need to be compared.
Mm-hmm. It made Bray a badass again, monster. Mm-hmm. Although it wasn't really on a compound, more of a like a swamp parking lot.
It looked like the backwoods at the Gathering of the Juggalos, to be quite honest. It felt very familiar to me.
It was mud. So, yeah. And yeah. But there are a couple like really cool things that happened. Like Eamon said, when we were talking about it, Braun Strowman running into that window of the truck. That was like a hellacious bump. And when he picked up the tire, I busted out laughing at that. Mm-hmm. But it was cool. And Xavier getting like knocked out and getting up later and coming back into the fight. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a really good showing for Xavier Woods. I think
it was also just it was doing something different than the Final Deletion. Because it took it to a serious route. They weren't trying intent. Maybe like you said, like, there's like one comical moment where like Braun grabs the tire because you're expecting to grab like a tire as a weapon. But like other than that, like it's done seriously. It's not more done to kind of like be comical and go in loose terms like go viral. You know what I mean? It's more done from a serious kind of point of view.
Where you use the pickaxe.
Yeah,
that's awesome. And that's the thing. It's hard to make the Wyatt scary with the lights on in the middle of a wrestling ring sometimes, mm-hmm. right? And I think they killed it on atmosphere. I don't know. I think in the long run, and again, I will watch it. I'll probably soft on this a bit, but I felt like they were a little strong on the filters. You know what I mean? Maybe they had a little too much style
shot
to this.
Like a Rob Zombie.
Yeah, they shot like a Rob Zombie film a little bit. With a Final Cut filter. It was good about setting atmosphere with these guys and like, hey, you know, yeah, they've lost in the middle of WrestleMania with the lights on, but this is what happens here, you know? And I think that's pretty cool. And Joe, I know you haven't seen the segment yet, but I know you've been kind of keeping an eye on the Wyatts and everything for a while too. At least leading into this, like from what you're getting the vibe of this, does it sound like it's in the right direction for these guys?
Well, I like the fact that again, it's not to overuse this term, but outside the box, and it's putting the Wyatts in more of their environment. Or so it seems, at least. There's so much more that can be done with the Wyatt characters that really has not been done in the run yet. And a lot of weeks they feel like just a few more people on the roster, and that's unfortunate. Seeing the slow burn of what seems to be them getting inside of Xavier Woods' head, whether it be mind control or brainwashing or just making him doubt himself, whatever the case is, it's very Kevin Sullivan to me, and that's a very good thing. Mm-hmm. These guys have to look dominant. They have to look like they can control you at a snap of their fingers, or they can at least be intimidating to you and feared. And a lot of times that was not accomplished, and they would get a couple of weeks of momentum and then it'd be gone. But if these guys can get a run where they just come off as the sadistic and bloodthirsty and animalistic and Manson-esque individuals who just want to control everybody and create chaos and destruction at a whim, I think that's the proper way to present the Wyatt family to the peak of their potential. And if it's going to lead to more segments, maybe not like this specifically, but in the general idea of this, where they stand out more and they can be in a different setting, or they can just be presented in a different way and felt a little bit less cookie cutter and overproduced, that will do the characters a lot of favors. Sometimes being different automatically makes it better. And I'd love to see more Wyatt family thinking that is against the grain of a normal WWE TV format.
Certainly. Well, we'll see where this goes. And of course, it is all running into battleground here in a couple of weeks, and we'll talk about that bit more next week in our and of course, if you guys join us live, we're going to be swapping it up because we're all going to go watch SmackDown and do the shows probably a bit later, probably about 11 o'clock p.m. Eastern time after SmackDown, after Indy Mayhem Show. So stick with us on that next week for some interesting flippery that we'll be doing there. All right, guys. Hey, I want to give a shout. If you like wrestling, if you like different stuff, you want to check out some of the guys that we've been talking about, Matt and Jeff Hardy, for instance, or a lot of the guys that we're going to be talking about with the Cruiserweight Classic, check out IndieWrestling.us. That's where you can find awesome stuff like IWC Super Indie 15. We've been talking about that over the last few weeks. Just the reviews, like some of the sites that have been like the hardest on indie wrestling that I've seen are coming out just roses about this show and how it came out. And of course, our friends at the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, our friends at Vicious Outcast Wrestling, 605 Wrestling, and something called Prime Wrestling has some stuff with somebody named Johnny Gargano. I don't know, Joe. There's a little something happening there.
That guy. We may have a little 20-hour Resolution anthology on there.
Well, there might be a lot of Resolution on there. You can look for myself and Eamon in the crowd at one of those, like three or four or whatever that was, right, Eamon?
Well, you're a ringside on one of them with the camera in hand.
I happen to be, yes, I'm the one with the green hat, I think. Yes. Why would you guys let me wear a green hat at ringside? I don't know, but
bro, there was a power outage that night and the ring broke. Who was worried about your freaking green hat?
You know, the fun part, I think during the pay-per-view, my camera didn't work the entire time. Like we were like, it got posted at a dinner or something like that. Like there was a few different things going on there. So
yeah, that was, one of the events that, even looking back on it, I'm very proud of it and how hard everybody worked, but that is why I do not miss booking shows on a grand level.
Yes, when Rhino and Jason Bane break your ring before intermission. Yes, but you can check that out and you can find that exact match and so much more on several different releases. Women of Prime, somebody just bought a Women of Prime I saw today. Best of Johnny Gargano, Volume 1 and 2. And, of course, he's been in NXT and it's going to be all over this Cruiserweight Classic coming up. And
I'll tell you what, the Women of Prime is on pace to probably be the best-selling of the Prime DVD releases. That's gotten a lot of good feedback. And it goes hand-in-hand with the popularity of women's wrestling these days. And a lot of great female talents who pop up on there before they ended up hitting it big later on.
Oh, certainly. And a lot. Well, that's a general trend on indiewrestling.us in general. Whenever there's a women's DVD like the Prime Wrestling one, or the Queen of the Ring that Vicious Outcast Wrestling's been doing, or single matches with IWC and RWA, those are consistently the top sellers as a genre, as individuals. So if we put top releases for matches individually, you'd probably see them just filling all of our slots there on the front page. So all that stuff, and of course other productions. Our friend Zach Gowen, the Finding Zach Gowen documentary. Of course, he made news with American Ninja Warrior recently. Montreal Theory, Legend of Virgil, and his traveling merchandise table, where Joe gets to sit next to Virgil once again and have a very interesting conversation.
Oh, what an honor it was.
that's just over a year old, isn't it?
We released it officially, I believe, maybe July 29th.
Oh,
so yeah,
we gotta
this
do
time
something.
A year ago, we were deep in pre-orders.
Deep in Virgil pre-orders. Go check it out. So much more digital downloads and the like. Sign up for the newsletter. You'll get information about Wrestling Mayhem Show, a free digital download of the IWC, including guys like AJ Styles over at the back at the 100th show for IWC back in 2009. Wow. You'll hear that voice, Joe Dombrowski, on it. You might see me at ringside too, on camera as well. So I think I worked there. It was one of those I didn't work. I can't remember which one it was. But anyways, go check that out. Free stuff. Sign up for indiewrestling.us. So speaking of a lot of those guys, there's the Cruiserweight Classic is finally happening. I watched the Bracketology special. Dang. It was kind of interesting to see who they talked about, who they didn't talk about in those lineups. I think they're very hot on Zack Sabre Jr., for instance. Rich Swann got a pretty good look there. Joe,
TJ Perkins.
TJ Perkins, definitely. They had a really good exchange there. I thought it was interesting that Triple H talked about this at the beginning of a brand. They do intend to have more tournaments, more CWC tournaments in the future. And it's a really interesting format. I can't wait to see how the show comes out. Of course, tapings are already in. I haven't read any spoilers, and I hope you aren't either. So, Joe, you take a look at the list. You've probably announced like a great number of these guys looking at the list.
Yeah.
What are your impressions? Well, first, what's your impression of just like the massive talent that they've accrued here?
I mean, it's impressive, obviously. And this is something that a lot of wrestling fans have really salivated for a number of years, for WWE to finally emphasize and put their resources behind the cruiserweights professional wrestling. And really, I think the WWE Network is the catalyst for so many new and original doors being opened that WWE would have never really thought to endeavor into in the past. Now that they've found a way to directly monetize the internet wrestling fan through things like NXT, and certainly even some of the more offbeat shows like the Edge and Christian show are very much catered to a specific niche type of fan. And I think there's a lot of crossover between that and certainly cruiserweight wrestling as well. So I'm excited to see what else we're going to see, because this is not certainly not the type of thing you'd see on a Monday Night Raw, or maybe a pandered toward an entire mass audience. But there is certainly a very passionate and growing market of wrestling fans that want to see so many of these talents, and WWE's relationship with the likes of Evolve and how they've kept up with promotions like PWG and Ring of Honor shows that they have their finger on that pulse and they recognize there's value there. So certainly would not be surprised to see a lot more of this as time goes on. I would hope that we would see no more, in my opinion, just one cruiserweight tournament a year. However, you don't want to oversaturate it, in my mind. Let's keep it special. Keep it like a Super Mini tournament or like a J Cup. Let's keep something special and something that is rare and unique. And who knows, perhaps a contract waiting in the wings for the winner.
Mm-hmm. And they haven't said what goes to the winner. They're just basically saying there's definitely going to be certain opportunities for them. And maybe that's something
right.
They reveal as they kind of determine. Maybe they don't have the winner in mind yet. officially permanently yet. You know, hey, people get injured, right? And mess
unique
up all those plans.
Unique opportunities.
But I'm sure there's a few roadmaps for however this tournament could go. I was impressed because I started kind of doing the math in my head, looking at the brackets for this thing and kind of thinking, like, this tournament's going to go for a long time. If they're presumably doing maybe like an hour-ish show like we see with NXT, let's say they pack four matches in there. Like, this is going to be several months that they do this, right? Right?
Yeah, likely, yeah. You don't want to rush it, and you want to give these guys time to showcase themselves and do their thing. And, you know, if it's a 60-minute show, or if they want to try to have international commitments on television, that might be, you know, 55 or 50, but whatever the case is. This is, again, catered to a niche market. It's catered to the type of fans that are watching indie wrestling, the type of fans that would, want to see a long, drawn-out athletic contest and not a 3 or 4 minute TV match. So I think we're going to get a lot of longevity and value out of this for quite a while to come, and hopefully the momentum keeps with it.
Eamon, of course, I think you've seen some of these people. Actually, I think you just announced some of these participants for your next Inspire Pro Wrestling show coming up. What do you think about the general look at the landscape here in this tournament?
I think it's great. I thought they came in with a very good mindset and a very good and I don't want to say, I guess theme may be the best word. I love the sort of international aspect of it all, and that, you know, there's so many countries that are being represented. I also watched the bracketology special, and I really liked how Daniel Bryan pointed out the fact that a lot of times cruiserweight wrestling gets labeled a certain way, in that it's just high flying, and that they brought in a group of people that have such a mix of styles to where you can see so much different stuff on a plane of a tournament. And I think that's something that's really appealing, kind of eye-catching, is to see how like a Zack Sabre Jr. would mesh with like a Grand Metallic or something along that lines. And seeing, it's a really good selling point, a really good way to kind of do this tournament. I'm very excited for it tomorrow. It's one of the things that I've really be anticipating for a good while, and yeah, it's definitely exciting.
Bobby FJ Town, what are your thoughts on this?
I said I haven't been this excited for a wrestling event in such a long time. I can't even remember watching the bracketology special. I didn't know a lot of the cruiserweights from around the world. Mm-hmm. Guys like, one of my favorite wrestlers this week is Jack Gallagher. I think he's like strongman John Hodgman, and I want them to sign him and put him in a stable with the Vaudevillians.
Right, that was my thought too. When they showed him, like, why he's the third Vaudevillian, obviously, mm-hmm. right? Or he reminds me of, and Joe, you remember this guy from your promotion, Jeremy Maddox. Madrox.
Yes. Remember him better than you do.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. Of course, you know, I think Team Hip Toss with Jock Sampson for a while. You know, like that kind of look. I love that that's going around. You know, that we're getting that kind of handlebar mustache. You know, character like that. You know, before it was cool in the Vaudevillians, right? So.
And I didn't know anything about T.J. Perkins, and his story just like reached out and was like, wow. Like, this guy's seen some shit.
Right. He was the guy that played Suicide.
Yeah.
On TNA. Like, that's all I knew about him. And that was pretty impressive. So, I kind of want to go down the line. Well, what are, like, kind of the top, like, maybe three or four guys to watch out for in your minds, especially you, Eamon, and Joe?
Well, to me, I want to get some dark horses in here too. I mean, Zack Sabre Jr. I'm going to name more than three. I'm just going to tell you right now.
Go for it. Go for it.
Zack Sabre Jr. jumps out to me because he's somebody who, along with you know, guys like Will Ospreay and Ricochet and guys like that, have gotten a ton of attention, mm-hmm. and has just star written all over him wherever he wants to wind up. You know, I'll be very intrigued to see how far he goes in the proceedings. Noam Dar is a name not a lot of people in North America are aware of, but I believe he's only 22, based out of Scotland, the first Israeli WWE superstar that anybody can confirm. And I don't know a lot about Noam, but I watched a couple of years ago on YouTube him have a match with AJ Styles, and it blew me away. He is very, very talented. And if he lived in the United States, he would have already blown up a lot bigger than he already has in this part of the country. Tony Nese is amazing to me because he has such a powerful frame and has a lot of muscle on him and a lot of amazing statistics in the gym, but he can fly and move so seamlessly. He's a guy to watch out for. Kota Ibushi, his reputation in Japan speaks for itself. He's a guy that a lot of people have heard of, but maybe not a lot have seen. And I think he'll blow a lot of people away. I will, echo the sentiment toward TJ Perkins. TJ's a favorite of mine, even though I'm very jealous because he's about 2 or 3 years older than me, but looks about 15 years younger than me. I hate him for it. But TJ, he's been through everything, man. Wrestling since he was a teenager, Anoki Dojo, lived in Mexico, been homeless, been a number of masked characters throughout his career, from Mannequin Suicide to, I believe, Sadistico in the old Lucha Libre USA, and Puma as well. A lot of characters he's played, but he really hasn't been able to be himself. And I think there's a lot of cool factor, and as the kids would say, there's a lot of swag to TJ Perkins that I think is going to hit an audience that WWE doesn't often tap into. Of course, Gargano and Ciampa have made a mark in WWE already, and I'm biased, but Gargano is my guy in this tournament because I've seen him be able to carry a brand more than once. And I'll also give a shout out to Mustafa Ali, who's wrestling Lince Dorado, because Mustafa Ali I saw in one of the Super Indies, I believe it was, as I blatantly look off camera, Super Indy 9, I believe was the year he was in for IWC, and he really impressed a lot of people that night. I believe he may have taken some time off after that or fallen off the radar a little bit, but great to see him back on the scene. Cedric Alexander is in the best shape of his life. I mean, you can go on and on. Very intrigued to see Tajiri and Kendrick involved in this as well. And of course, my boy Tyson Dukes from Canada, Border City Wrestling, been in the game 20 plus years. He's done some enhancement work for WWE, but finally getting a big shot. And Drew Gulak as well. And to the example of you made earlier about it's not all high-flying wrestling. Gulak is a throwback. He's a mat wrestler. He's a tactician. He very much looks like he belongs in a different era, but he's able to modernize it and survive and thrive in 2016 as well. I'm very happy for Drew to get this opportunity as well. So you got a melting pot of so many different styles and cultures involved. And I think a lot of those more established names are going to be the bulk that escapes the first round. But once we get into quarterfinals, semifinals, I think it's going to keep getting more and more intriguing to see who lasts the longest, especially the guys who are not quote-unquote WWE guys. How far will TJ Perkins go? How far will Noam Dar go? We don't really know. And I'm very intrigued to see in a WWE-branded event somebody who is free and clear to do their own thing. How long are they going to be spotlighted? And will somebody earn a contract?
Definitely, yeah. I agree completely. A lot of those names, like I said, stick out. TJ Perkins was one that obviously, like you said, his multiple different gimmicks he has done before. And I knew obviously of him. I saw him wrestle live WrestleMania weekend against Ricochet at one of the Evolve shows. And just that performance alone made me a fan of his immediately. There's something about his style that's just so unique and is really eye-catching. I also agree definitely with Drew Gulak. I think Gulak's style, I'm more intrigued to see how he will be received, in the sense, like you said, his style is so bare bones and very not, it's not flashy, but it's very technical. And if you can appreciate that side of things, you'll really enjoy his work. Another one that really sticks out to me that I was very excited about once he got announced was Akira Tozawa. I think he is mega talented, both in ring, but also he has a great personality that if he's able to showcase that as well, I think will, you know, lead him far in the tournament. And I'm excited, to see people who I only vaguely know of. Like, I've only seen one Jack Gallagher match, that being his qualifying match in the tournament for, I believe, Progress. I've heard a lot of Noam Dar, but I've never got to see his work, so I'm very excited to see what he brings to the table. There's a lot of talented people in this tournament, a lot of people can look forward to, I feel.
The next thing they need to do, think logically, women's tournament.
Mm-hmm. I could see that happening. I can very much see that happening.
Definitely. I mean, I think there's a lot of structure out there, much like there is for these guys coming in. Between all of your shines and WSUs and other promotions out there, they seem to be popping up every day. And like we were just talking about on the ad break, Joe, like that's what people are responding to. I think if you said, "Hey, we're going to do a women's show," I think a lot of people will show up for, well, you know, the right and wrong reasons. They show up, right?
The money spends as well, no matter who is buying the ticket or who's buying the network subscription. Mm-hmm. You know, there's different types of fans and mm-hmm. different types of things that appeal to different types of people. And that's just part of the business. It's cosmetic. You know, I mean, there's going to be people that would watch a women's tournament because they enjoy eye candy. There's going to be people watching this cruiserweight tournament because of eye candy. Let's not deny that. TJ Perkins is an adorable man. It's just part of the business. And I don't think, you know, as long as these fans don't cross a line and as long as they respect and appreciate the athletic skill that's being presented, to me, I could not care less, how they think or how they feel or how they process any of this. As long as they know they're getting some damn fine wrestling talent, they should certainly respect and be happy that they're getting.
Certainly. Well, let us know your thoughts, guys, on the CWC, the Cruiserweight Classic. WWE, of course, is going to premiere this week, and depending on when you listen to the show, maybe it's already happened. But I'm sure even just the first episode, we're only going to get a taste of what we're going to end up seeing at this thing. So, Joe Dombrowski, thank you so much for joining us and give us some insight on what's going on here with the tournament, with the Final Deletion, and joining us on the show.
Well, thank you for having me. It's always a pleasure to make my contractually obligated annual visit. You know, if my rambling can help or inform somebody, then, I'm happy to do it, because if I wasn't invited on this show, I would probably just be turned around and talking to the wall.
Usual Tuesday night in the Dombrowski compound.
That's where all the shouting comes from.
What's the latest coming up? Where should people be looking for you on the internet for new things?
Well, you could check out my website at joe-dombrowski.com for all of my original DVD works, and certainly links to indiewrestling.us for the digitals as well. Classic memorabilia, action figures. I'll be adding several dozen more coming up this week if I have the time. Hundreds of vintage magazines, rare trinkets and collectibles, my schedule, and a whole lot more. I'm on the social media, facebook.com/Joe Dombrowski Wrestling, at Joe_Dombrowski on Twitter and Instagram. And also you can get to my YouTube page through my website as well. I currently am manning 4 different YouTube pages, totaling a combined over 1.5 million hits between all 4 of them. Feel free to check them out, and just a cavalcade, a plethora of great wrestling merchandise, great wrestling clips, I should say. Back at my website is also the outsourced announcing tab. I can voice over your events, individual matches, demos, commercials, bar mitzvahs, and much more, either solo or with a variety of eclectic personalities, including but not limited to The Chise, Shane Douglas, and James E. Cornette, and many others. I do that from home. Usually about 5 or 6 in the morning, and I cannot guarantee I'm wearing pants at the time either. So not only do you get that mystery, but you get to avoid all overhead costs as far as travel, lodging, etc. And in addition to that, stay posted, people in Cleveland, Ohio, got a cool announcement coming up because I'm bringing something to you in the month of August. So stay posted to my social media because there's a lot more for me on the way, more than I can probably handle.
Always, right? Well, thank you so much. And follow him on, make sure you do follow him on Facebook, Twitter. Joe does, when he's bored, some great Q&As.
Yes, I'm usually not bored. It's not that I'm bored. It's just that I'm in a situation I don't want to be and can't get away from. That's usually what it is.
Distract him. Exactly. So always good. Always good to pick his brain. I've been on many a car rides with him to shows and other events, and we've had some great conversations over the years. In related news, I'm sorry, I have to say this. And Joe, if you know, the thing is, the perfect you being the contrarian, because even Vince McMahon is on Pokemon Go apparently. There's a Gastly in his gym that he's telling to get out.
Get his win back.
Gotta get his win back, yeah. But anyways, hey, shout out. We're going to go to the break in a moment, and we're going to do our big question and the match selection for our Mayhem draft here. But in the meantime, please go check out our friends Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. And of course, up here in the Beachview area where there's lots of Pokemon, by the way. I'm trying to catch them all. But also, if you are in town, Cole Cabana for the recent Cubs games, maybe. They're also down at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates, down on Main Street in Carnegie, PA. Go check them out. They have a pizza mascot. We're talking about it over on AwesomeCast. There's a pizza mascot that's been going around with them. So check them out. SliceandBroadway.com, PGH_Slice. Still working on that pizza crate for Bobby FJ Town. I was talking to Rico just last week about it. He humored me, at least. So I think that's a win. I think that's a win.
Next month's themes and anchovies.
There you go. PGH_Slice on Twitter and Slice on Broadway on Facebook and Instagram. We'll be right back with a big question.
Amigos, you're listening to the Wrestling Mayhem Show. And in case you forgot, my name is Armando Alejandro. Just don't show me.
We are back. It is the Wrestling Mayhem Show. It's time for the big question. Riz is joining us so he can represent Team Raw in the draft here in a little bit. We're going to unveil 100%. our matches that we've made with our amazing rosters, and then there's SmackDown. Represent, of course, Eamon 2, please, with us still, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, and Bobby FJ Town, representing Team SmackDown. But we'll get to that in a few moments, right, guys?
Yes, indeed.
It's a big question. We kind of hinted at the Vince McMahon and having problems with the Gastly in his gym. That sounds like a personal problem, actually. But anyways, so there's a phenomenon sweeping the nation right now, and it is Pokemon Go. So I thought if each of you could pick a team, because all you guys were playing Pokemon Go on the break. Was it Team Mystic, Team Valor, and Team...
Actually, sorry, it's Team Valor.
Valor. Oh, wait, hold on a second.
Great callback.
Hold on a second. Let me write that on my card.
Valor.
Valor. Valor. Fuck you, Riz.
Now he's going to call him Valor for the entire night.
Damn it. What was the other team? Seriously, I can't remember. Instinct. Instinct.
Incest.
Instinct.
So incest. I want you.
That's a weird.
No, it's not. No.
I want you to pick a team, and I think I'm going to have each of the three of you pick a different team, so the last one gets stuck with one. Pick a team, and who would you pick if wrestlers were Pokemon as your lead of that team?
This is gonna be so amazing.
This
or
is
ridiculous.
A joke. Dombrowski was wondering what.
Can I clarify? Because I vaguely know about Pokemon.
Okay.
So the Valor and was it Miss
Valor?
Mystic.
Valor. Hold on. Valor is strength.
Yeah.
Mystic is like magic and stuff.
Blue.
No.
They're just teams, Sorg.
Yeah, but I'm saying do they entail certain things?
And
they're just colors.
They're just colors of the rainbow.
Yeah, and one's a fiery bird, one's an electricity bird, and the other one is...
Stupid bird.
Stupid bird.
So which one's the stupid bird?
Blue.
Blue. That's Mystic.
I'm going to pick for Team Mystic, and I pick Matt Hardy.
It's like the SmackDown draft with Pokemon.
Oh, man. Let's see. Now, do we have to compare like which Pokemon to which guy?
You don't have to. I wasn't going that far with it. Especially, I didn't want to screw up Eamon that bad. And guys, I can barely answer these questions. But I figured we have enough people. I thought this could be an interesting conversation.
I'll pick Insight. Right? Is that the one too?
Instinct. Yeah. Instinct.
Yeah. I'll take Insight and pick. The Machamp is here, John Cena.
Ooh.
Oh, I was going to pick a Machamp, but a different one.
From Instinct? Okay. Okay.
My Machamp.
Bobby, you have it right there. You have the name right in front of you.
My Machamp is half shark Brock Lesnar.
For Valor, I take it?
Yeah, for Valor. For Valor!
Valor.
For Valor.
No, the card says Valor, okay? Jeez.
And who's the NXT champ?
Roman is Snorlax, according to the chat room.
And by the way, to get to the whole, we all know from what we heard probably about 2 years ago that Natalya is Ghastly.
No wonder Vince wants Ghastly out of the gym so bad.
No, in fairness, Roman Reigns is actually, if you play Pokemon Go, Roman Reigns is actually Rattata, because it's the one you get all the time but never want.
That's Weedle for me.
Yeah, that's Weedle. Yeah.
I have an army of EVs at this point.
What's that one that's like a clown? That'd be Dean Ambrose.
Mr. Mime?
Mr. Mime would be Dean Ambrose.
You think I don't know.
Oh, also, Bobby. Sorry, Bobby.
Also, I did name one of my Pokemon Squirt Henning.
That is...
Oh, wow.
What is that?
Wow.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
I think I saw that on like one of the reviews of... Was that on the review of the Sunny Porn?
I don't know.
We're not getting into that. No. All right, on that That's point, let us know if you have any Pokemon-related wrestling thoughts. Tyler Breeze, of course, there was a segment I think we mentioned briefly. I can't remember if it was on or off air about that.
That shared
over on wrestling.
By the way, I want to point out that Bailey is a Jigglypuff, a precious, precious Jigglypuff.
Yes, yes, she is. So it's time... It's time to find out weeks after weeks as I'm trying to move on and forget about my horrible big question. WWE Draft, Mayhem Draft. We've been creating and curating these rosters for Team Raw and Team SmackDown here, represented by our crews. And
Team Raw won. But
now we're going to find out who won. We're going to find out. In the only way we know how, Eamon, what are we doing this week?
This week, in the spirit of, it's not the next pay-per-view, but SummerSlam's coming up. In the spirit of that, I think that it's only appropriate that we draft our SummerSlam cards based off our rosters, because what is a drafted roster if not something you can fantasy book the shit out of? So we're going to do that here. And book our shows. I kind of laid out the rules to everyone in the beginning that there will be 8 matches. I believe I said including one pre-show. So that it's 8 total that includes a pre-show. So based off of that, we draft our cards. And since it really doesn't matter who goes first, since everybody has their...
it doesn't freaking matter anymore.
Well, it doesn't, because everybody has their rosters. I'll give it a Team Raw. Team Raw, you can go first.
Okay.
You can lead off.
So are we doing the pre-show first?
Yeah, we're starting top or bottom of the card?
You can do whatever order you want.
All right. Wait, are we doing top to bottom or bottom to top?
I think we should start on the pre-show.
Raising.
We should start on the pre-show?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. So, we haven't decided on our pre-show yet.
All right. So you guys actually helped us with our pre-show.
Okay.
Because I saw last week you guys did you guys choose Goldust for us, or is that?
No, I think you chose
Goldust. We chose Goldust. You gave us Truth, though.
Did we?
Somebody, I want to say, I could be wrong, but anyways, did we?
I thought we gave that.
I have no idea. I'm going to pull up my list because I'm confused now.
Because I thought I saw.
Anyways, what's the match?
Well, first, let me check to see if it's the right one so we don't have to use them.
Right, because keep in mind, the pre-show match must include at least one member of the people that the opposing team drafted for you.
Mayhem Draft, here we go. Never mind. Anyways, so we had to go to the draw. Actually, I want
to
know.
It has to. Your pre-show match, I should say this. Your pre-show match has to include one of these five people.
Okay, I see it right now, though.
It has to include either Rosa Mendez, Jey Uso, Victor, Epico, or Sawyer Fulton.
So I'm going to – I could have sworn I saw him. And let's see. So if you guys want to go first.
Okay, let's start on the other end of the card, okay? Yeah. We'll work that out.
Yes, let's do the other end. So go ahead.
Okay. You want to do the – fuck, I'm confused.
Sure, let's do the main event, Sork.
Your
main event.
What's our main event, Riz?
AJ Styles versus Seth Rollins.
Okay.
Period.
End of story. It's going to be an amazing match.
Best wrestling match on the card.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So let's do one of our top matches.
Okay.
Nobody's responding, so it's just me and Bobby. So me and Bobby are ruling the show. Okay. Bobby, do you think the one we agreed? Why am I even saying this? We don't have to be secretive. Don't let them see the roster we already have. Are you cool with? Yeah, I do the Mr. Never Give Up versus the current NXT
just
champion.
Just say it. Why are you being so cryptic?
I'm trying to get Bobby's confirmation.
Yeah, I guess so.
A couple people in our group agreed on that, so I think it's fair. We're gonna go with that because none of them are responding, so we're doing whatever the fuck we want. John Cena versus Samoa Joe.
Okay.
The top echelon of WWE versus the top echelon of TNA/Ring of Honor.
Man, a lot of faith in that Samoa Joe there. All right.
Yeah.
All right.
So, Sorg, you want to do that next one?
Hold on. I'm bringing up the Slack because I went somewhere else. I'm just going to name one, okay? I'm going to name one of those. That one. I want to go Austin Aries versus Dean Ambrose.
Okay.
Austin
Aries versus Dean Ambrose. Okay.
So I go ahead.
Let's see. So next match on our card. I'm trying to see what Bobby put out there.
This is compelling.
Bobby, because I'm looking at the ones Bob you suggested, Bobby.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think doing that triple threat, but with just the first two guys, because that third guy I had an idea for?
Again, we don't have to be cryptic.
Yeah, we don't have to be secret.
We're not stealing your guys anymore.
the match that's going to happen at Battleground.
Okay.
You cool with that?
Oh, yeah. That's fine.
Yeah. Our second match is Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens.
Hmm. I'd like to see that, too.
What can go wrong with that?
All right.
Forever.
Let's see. All right. So we got... And now we have to have the women's match. Yeah, so why not Charlotte versus Paige?
Okay.
The women's title. Continue.
Go ahead.
Is my women's match too much?
I think it's a little too much. Just a little.
Is it Hell in a Cell?
Sasha versus Asuka.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah.
That's a good one. I like that. I like that.
That's insane and normal. Can I say my match that I was thinking
of? Say your match that you were thinking of.
The first ever women's Money in the Bank match between Asuka, Bayley, Sasha Banks, Becky Lynch, Nia Jax, and Billie Kay.
Because, of course, Billie Kay.
Because I had to sneak Billie Kay in there. She's my girl.
Sure.
Come on.
Okay.
Come on. But that, no, it's Sasha versus
Asuka. We'll let that one happen at Bobby Slam.
So, Sorg, say the one Wheels just posted.
You know what? Yeah, I like that one, actually.
Yeah.
I think we go with that one. Let's do Apollo Crews versus Mark Henry.
What? Okay.
What, do we steal yours? Is that what you're talking about?
No, we can't steal
theirs.
Big Show would be smart.
Yeah,
I'm making sure everyone gets somewhat appreciated in this, even though people aren't responding to stuff.
I want to do like a little background on this one because I think I got a good idea for this, how to work that triple threat.
Bobby, how about that four-way that Mike suggested?
Yeah, that works. Because the tag team one?
Yeah.
Yeah, that works.
Tag team, Fatal 4-Way. American Alpha versus The Revival versus Gargano and Ciampa versus the Primetime Players.
Ooh.
Okay.
Bring them back to Primetime Players. I like it.
Nice.
Can I have a question?
With Bob Backlund.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you.
That was going to be my question.
Thank you. I give them points on that one. It's just...
That was a good one. So...
Taking Titus under
his chin. The reason why I wanted to do this one was I wanted a little backdrop here.
Are you going to do an audio vignette for us?
This is the pre-show, right?
No. No, this is not the pre-show yet.
We still have four more matches.
Yeah. So let's say I think Big Cass with Enzo in his corner.
No, because we have Enzo.
Oh yeah, that's right. You have Enzo. Yeah. Fucking never mind that. So Big Cass.
Enzo on loan. We'll give you
We'll
let you borrow Sara Lee or something for that.
Yeah. So Big Cass is feuding with The Miz. Now The Miz doesn't want to face him one-on-one.
Okay.
So it is going to be Big Cass versus The Miz and Baron Corbin for the Intercontinental title.
For the triple threat?
Yes.
Okay. Just checking. Okay.
You like how I did that there?
Yeah. Bobby, the first one Mike suggested, and I also suggested it as well.
Yeah, it works.
I think that's money. One-on-one, the first time in America. Shinsuke Nakamura versus Brock Lesnar.
Oh, my. The vignettes alone. You like that last one?
I thought we had another one.
With them? I don't remember seeing anything.
I like that better.
Yeah. Let's break it up. Let's do something interesting.
Mm-hmm.
You know? All right. We're going to do Cesaro against Big E.
Okay.
That'd be good.
I dig that. Dig that.
Yeah. And then Wheels posted another one that I really like.
Bobby, I'm going to leave it to you. What do you want to go with next?
All right, we'll see.
What tickles your fancy?
You'll see what we have, because we've run out of matches that we...
Yeah, I keep on forgetting what...
Pretty much.
Like, What's available?
Unless you want to go with mats, which I don't
know.
Ooh, yes, Sorgis.
Let's see who we got left here. This is a great podcast. I apologize.
Yes.
Yeah, it is.
We should really prepare for something like this.
We probably should.
Yeah. We tried to.
Oh, Bobby, let's do something with Neville.
Okay.
Since he's now uninjured. Ooh, maybe Neville again. How does Neville against Tadeo Itami sound?
That's what I was thinking, exact same thing.
Okay, then let's do that. Let's do that.
I was thinking the exact same thing.
I like that idea.
The return from injury match.
Yes. The you're back match.
Surprise, you're back.
Ooh. Sorg.
Keep in mind, you got one more main match, and then you have to do a big show.
Oh, fuck.
Okay. Hey, that last thing, let's just make that a four-way.
But Sorg, I'm gonna throw something to you.
Okay, I'm gonna catch it. I think it right over here.
Let me double check. I want to make sure we have everything correct.
Just write it and I'll double check. You know what? Say it.
I mean, we have Bray White. We have Bray White, right?
Yeah.
Sorg, I'm gonna post it.
Finn. Type.
Okay.
There. No. Not
you
yet.
Said
I heard
it.
What you said.
Wait, you said
I know
it.
What you, I know what you heard, but I'm double checking. Do you think Finn versus Bray?
That's interesting.
Yes. Okay. Finn versus Bray. The Battle of the Entrances. I think we've had that match named in both of Mayhem Manias and now this. Continue.
What do you think, Bobby? What do you think about another women's match?
Yeah. I was thinking we kind of need that because we do have a lot of women's
talent. Because right now we've got – I'm just going to – because we basically need – done. It doesn't matter. We've got Bailey. We've got Becky. We've got Nikki.
Nia Jax.
We've got Dana Brooke.
Billy Kay. Summer Rae.
What about Aiden? Maybe
Battle Royal.
Well, Battle Royal, or maybe we could do your idea.
Money in the Bank match? For the ladies? Might as well.
Who cares? Let's do it. Let's do that. Money in the Bank match. Bailey versus Becky Lynch versus Nikki Bella versus Nia Jax versus Dana Brooke. Versus Eva Marie versus Summer Rae versus Billy Kay.
We forgot Liv Morgan.
No, they have Liv Morgan.
Oh, they have Liv Morgan. Oh, that's Sorg. Right. That's right. Yeah, they do have Liv
Sorg.
Morgan.
I just threw that out there. Just ignore it. Even the ladies.
Nothing says we can't.
Do you want to do it?
Let's break the mold.
So for the pre-show, we're doing something different.
A little bit different. It's kind of the same. It's kind of the same, but a little bit different.
Everybody that's not mentioned gets thrown into a battle royal.
Sweet. Even the ladies.
Nice.
That's your pre-show?
That's our pre-show match.
Okay.
Not all the time.
Winner gets a title shot of their choosing.
And we should get mayhem points for including all of our pre-show nominees.
Yep. That's pre-show, bonus points.
Raw battle. Wins. Royal with everyone.
with everyone left.
And the winner and the winner gets a title shot of their choice at Night of Champions.
Yeah.
Night of Champions. Which is now Clash of Champions.
Okay, so
do you want to go with the one I suggested for pre-show match?
Yeah.
All right.
I like that idea. Because I can't really think of anything else.
Okay. Since you guys lovingly gave us Mojo Rawley, we're going to have Mojo Rawley versus No Way Jose in a last man dancing match.
Can I, oh, wait, actually, the chess piece is not on the board. The chess piece is not on the board yet. Okay. I just realized something.
It's
not on the board yet.
Just let it be. Just let it be.
Oh, yeah. What were you suggesting?
Bobby, can I make it a four-way?
Is it still a last man dancing match?
Sure.
Is your thumb still
Mojo Rawley.
Okay.
No Way Jose.
Oh, we got Fandango, too.
We got Fandango, we got Enzo Amore, and we got Xavier Woods.
You're gonna put...
You put everyone in a battle royal!
Yeah,
that's true.
I'll allow it.
Last man dancing means you have to dance and fight, and you have to continually dance while you're fighting.
Way Jose versus Mojo Rawley versus Fandango versus...
You know, throw Ty Dillinger in there, too.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, you know what? That's a good idea. I like that idea.
Hold on, let me see if there's anyone else that dances.
But put him in a suit.
He does cartwheels. Put him in a suit. This isn't Mania.
Hold on. I want to make sure there's nobody else that we have that dances. Bo Dallas kind of does a dance. I don't know. Heath Slater?
Yes.
One-man band?
Yeah, do it. Do it. Don't be pussy, do it.
Don't be a pussy.
Don't be a pussy. Do it.
Yeah, just because of the theme of Last Man Dancing, I think it makes more sense.
They didn't even use Chris.
We have the weirdest.
He's in a.
But in fairness, neither does is WWE.
Yeah, that's true.
We have the weirdest minds in all of wrestling fandom.
Okay, well, so let me run down these cards.
So, what do these cards look like?
I can't wait.
Raw is SummerSlam. Features a pre-show match with everybody not on the show. Finn Balor versus Bray Wyatt.
Mm-hmm. We might throw Cesaro in...
versus... What?
Nothing. I was going to say, we might throw people in there that aren't even wrestlers.
Sure, why not? Cesaro versus Big E. Balor. Big Cass versus The Miz versus Baron Corbin as we're set for the Intercontinental title. Apollo Crews versus Mark Henry. Charlotte versus Paige, assuming for their women's title. Austin Aries versus Dean Ambrose. And AJ Styles versus Seth Rollins, the main event. You guys didn't use Roman at all? Holy shit.
Nope.
No, we almost did.
30 days.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
He's going to win and get a title shot of his shoes.
Yes. For SmackDown, our SummerSlam, features a pre-show last man dancing match. No Way Jose versus Mojo Rawley versus Fandango versus Enzo Amore versus Xavier Woods versus Heath Slater. Women's Money in the Bank ladder match. Bayley versus Becky Lynch versus Nikki Bella versus Summer Rae versus Billy Kay versus Nia Jax versus Eva Marie versus Dana Brooke.
Got lots of ladies.
Somebody's going to get hurt.
Someone's
going
to die.
Most likely Billy Kay, because nobody knows who she is.
Oh, come on. She could have been on SmackDown 2 weeks ago.
Tell me people don't want to see Eva Marie in a ladder match. Like, tell me people wouldn't want to see that.
I mean, you guys picked her.
Yeah. Neville versus Hideo Itami. Shinsuke Nakamura versus Brock Lesnar. For our tag titles, American Alpha versus The Revival versus Gargano and Ciampa versus the Primetime Players. For our women's title, Sasha Banks versus Asuka, Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens, and John Cena versus Samoa Joe. Man, does that card look sexy?
Yes, our card does look sexy.
Yes, it does.
Man, I wish we had one more match, though. Because the one we had, like...
Do you want to do one more match? Because I can pick one more match.
How about we do one more match? Let's do one more match.
One more match. One more match. One more match.
This is like when SummerSlam went from 2 to 3 hours.
Sword,
which one? 24 hours this year again.
Sword, which one of your two do you want? Do you want the Kalisto versus Kofi? Yeah, let's do Kalisto versus Kofi.
Yeah, I dig it.
Let's do it.
Burn the house down.
Do it.
Okay. Kalisto versus Kofi Kingston.
Burn the house down with fireworks.
Flippy things.
So I'm in between two things, Bobby.
Okay.
In between two matches. I'm thinking either Andrade Cien Almas versus Ty Dillinger. Two out of three falls.
Kai's already in the dance off.
No, he's not.
No, he's not.
Oh, we took him out of there?
Okay. Right, because I put in Heath Slater instead.
Oh, okay.
So he's still on the board. So I'm thinking either something with that or something with Jericho and one of them.
I would kind of want to see a triple threat with those three.
Okay.
You want to do that?
Yeah. Let me see if there's any. I just want to look at our roster. Anybody else? See if there's anybody else that I feel like needs to be on there. No? Yeah. Yeah, how about that?
Sounds good.
I like that. Chris Jericho versus Andrade, Deanna Omas versus Ty Dillinger.
I love how Eamon said it too.
He's got a weird name. Okay, WWE, stop it with that name.
I thought I had problems with pronunciations.
It should just be
sad.
This is it. So we're going to put these up, and we're going to have somebody vote on what is the better card.
What is the better SummerSlam card? So, what would you drop down your $9.99 for?
Are we drafting announcers next week?
We can. Do you want to draft announcers real quick?
We're doing it now.
Let's do it.
Let's do it live.
Wait.
Fuck it.
We still need to do like GM and commissioner.
No, we won't do GM.
Let's just leave it there. Leave it there.
WWE already made it too complicated with that.
Coin to go first.
I got a coin. And you know what? I'll leave. Here's a fun thing. I'll leave announcers open. No rules for announcers. Do whatever you want. I'll say three guys. Yeah, you can do three guys. Okay, and Sword Call heads or tails?
Tails, baby.
Oh, it's heads. Okay. Oh, it's heads. You know what? I'm just gonna openly discuss it. Whatever. Bobby, I'm thinking Corey Graves.
Yeah.
Corey Graves, commentator for
us. It was between
son of a bitch.
People.
Sword.
Oh shit! Yeah. That last
Mauro
one.
Mauro and Aloe.
God damn it.
Mauro.
That was the other person
Mauro
I was thinking
the
of, too.
Best damn announcer.
I like Mauro, but sometimes he makes weird references.
You make weird
I
references.
I love his weird references.
I do. That's why we love him. Who else? Let's see. Let's think about this, Bobby. Who else do we got? And I'm pretty open with this.
What do we get to Todd Phillips?
And
I don't think that's on the table, Riz.
It's not on the table. Are you sure?
Hold on, we'll ask when it's our turn. We'll let them go. Okay. We'll ask if that's legal.
Renee Young.
Okay, everyone in our fucking hangouts or in our Slacks behind.
Renee Young.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking Renee actually.
Renee's good on commentary.
I think Renee could be good.
We'll go Renee Young.
We're gonna go Renee Young. We need a female presence.
Yeah. Question from the gallery here. Mm-hmm. Are we allowed to pick any commentator?
What do you mean?
Like, does he have to be in WWE?
You know what? I'll say no.
We pick Eamon Payton.
What?
Oh, no.
This is like when Paul Heyman got drafted to Raw when he was drafting for SmackDown.
Heyman just puts his head down and walks.
No, I'll do the Paul Heyman thing and yell and quit it at David Bischoff. No, I'll look at it, fine. Is that really your pick?
Yep.
Jesus Christ.
Then can we have Joe Dombrowski?
I'm between two people.
Well, here's the other question. Would you pick yourself or would you pick Joe Dombrowski?
No, I would never pick myself.
What if you're given the choice?
Who was I thinking of? Fuck, I had it for... Oh, I'm in between two people, Bobby.
And Garza, if you're listening...
I can't read your mind.
I want Captain Eamon.
Yeah, oh yeah, Captain Eamon.
He has to have the captain's hat.
Tomorrow, Captain Eamon.
Bobby, let me know what I'm about to post in... the Slack. Let me know what you think. Compared to
are we behind the Slack?
Yeah, I'm sure they are. I don't know why they're fucking so slow.
Oh yeah, go for it.
You think?
Yes.
That's better?
Definitely.
You guys may have Mauro Ranallo.
And you.
But the person he's calling with every Wednesday night, we got over on SmackDown. We got Daniel Bryan.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Yes. Yes.
Fucks. Oh, we had to fuck around and pick Eamon.
Let's see.
We need a good. You know what? I was gonna say we need a good color. Like, what?
No, that would be no. You know what? No, Stryker wouldn't be good with Mauro.
Yeah, they're too similar.
Yeah,
similar guys.
That's why I'm surprised Mauro does so well, considering like they didn't like it when Stryker did it.
Yeah.
Ooh, sword.
No, that's too much. I mean, that's too much.
He's doing. You think it's too much?
Even my pick is too much.
Yeah, that's a little too much too.
Yeah. Oh, they made all their picks. So yeah, no, Vampiro. I don't know.
Who's the guy calling it with JR?
You know what?
You should go with Josh Matthews.
Fuck it.
Yeah, do it.
I think we need a king.
Mm-hmm.
The proper king.
Nope.
King Carino.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Mike won't watch your show then.
Super king.
You know what? That's okay. We might not have Mike watching our show, but we'll have Joe Dombrowski watching our show. King Carino is a scholar and a gentleman. I would appreciate working with him on the Montreal Theory.
We have Mauro, Carino, and
Eamon.
Eamon,
you're going to work with King Carino.
Living the dream.
Eamon, you're going to love Steve Carino.
Yeah. I like ours, though. We got Corey Graves, we got Renee Young, and Daniel Bryan.
But you get to sit in the chair next to Corino.
It's a great realistic combination of people.
You're going to be...
We have a combination of people that could probably actually happen one day.
Eamon...
Oh, I'm sorry. Did you not say that everything was possible?
Everything is possible, man. Eamon, I imagine Eamon in the Byron Saxton role on Raw.
Shut the fuck up.
And Carino's just gonna berate you all night. It's gonna be fantastic.
Notice how we pick none of the Raw teams.
Just yelling in Eamon's ear all night.
you pick literally no one on the Raw team. Like, we picked literally no one on the main roster team, and you picked someone with, like, 3 years of experience.
Yep.
Eamon, do you want us to pick somebody else?
No, that's fine. You go with who you want to go with.
It's amazing.
Oh, Wheels is picking a ring announcer.
Do you have ring announcers, too? Okay, fine. Pick your ring announcer.
I want to pick Eve.
She's on. Well,
we picked you as a commentator. We can pick.
Yeah.
Eve.
Okay. Fine. Yeah. You said Eve or Eden?
Oh, Eden. Wait. What?
You get Eve Torres then.
No.
Our thumb is still on the chest piece.
She's an alien on Supergirl.
Chest piece, not chest piece.
Yeah. Oh.
That's sexist.
In that case, if we get anyone, Bobby.
Mm-hmm.
Melissa Santos?
Yeah, take her.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh. I will take. We'll take.
Did you say Matt?
From the 559.
Dude, the following
Lucha is scheduled for
Riz, ask Alex, man. We got to sit beside her like all night at the thing I can't talk about.
She's pretty great.
I bet she smells of lilacs and power like Stephanie McMahon.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, I don't know. Alex was closer than I was. Like, Alex was, like, right beside her the entire night.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, no more picks.
Alex Cars, please hit us up on Twitter and let us know what Melissa Santos, what's it taste like? Smell like. Smells like.
That got weird, Sorg.
Hey. Hit the wall.
I mean.
I can only tell you what Ron Funches smells like, so.
Probably weed.
It was weed and nachos because of catering, but
weed and wrestling.
You know what? It's to be quite honest, it was Los Angeles. Almost everything smells like weed, so it's weed and Mexican food. Anyways, that was the draft. That was the draft.
Ended with the bag.
Everything that we have done has gone completely off the rails.
Uh-huh. Right, because that's what we do here, Riz, on the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
It was fun.
So, guys, I want to know, finally, what did you learn from wrestling this week?
Boop, 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 boop. I learned Kevin Owens is an asshole.
Not coming out until he leaves. Big work environment.
So good.
It's good. Really, really, it's good. Awesome. It's amazing. Riz?
Come back to me.
Bobby?
I learned that Fandango doesn't know what Pokemon are, and it's the greatest thing ever.
Oh, I learned what makes Breeze Dango's clothes. Mongolian chinchillas.
Ooh.
That was from a pre-show. They did a whole segment and match dedicated to a pre-show gag done by the Lucha Dragons on Tyler Breeze.
Are they the greatest accidental tag team ever, maybe?
Mm.
I don't know. I really miss Slater Gator.
Yeah,
Slater Gator, which exploded last night. Sad
You know what? I learned to love the Hardys again.
Somebody's got them.
Somebody's got them.
By the way,
if they don't love themselves,
they both need hugs.
I also learned, by the way, I just got this message. This just in, live here on the show. A friend of the show, Krista Joseph.
Yes.
Who probably can also tell us what Melissa Santos smells like.
We should ask him.
I don't think that's a good idea.
You can, because he's going to be on the Midweek War.
Yes, and he will be on not just for the Lucha.
Wait. The tweet says, currently, Krista Joseph watching Impact Wrestling Destination X in preparation for his appearance this week on Mayhem Show Midweek War.
Yes, indeed. He will be talking not just the second part of Ultimate Lucha Dos, but he will also be talking about Impact Wrestling and NXT. So we've had him on the show before. It's always great to have him on. Very excited to have Krista Joseph for the first time on the Midweek War to talk about midweek professional wrestling and get his thoughts on it. So we're very excited to see that.
Somebody responded, "Hope you're drunk." Also from the chat, I'm sorry, not from the chat, but the chat, please let us know what you learned. Wheels learned that Team Raw rules with a Z. Chris LaRusso, as we discussed earlier, from the Hardys themselves, the original plan for the Final Deletion was going to be even more insane. And so the image we used was the I Still Have Feelings for Matt Hardy picture for the What Did You Learn This Week. Rick Haynes, he says, except for Still Have Feelings, except for where Brother Nero is concerned. Mwahahaha. And I want to double check if there was anything else, but if there's anything else you guys learned, Garza is going to hate us for the graphics this week. Yeah, he probably is. Yeah, he's probably not going to be too happy with us here.
Put everybody in the Battle Royal in a suit.
He has a lot of work ahead of him if he's doing that. So it may take us a minute because we have to actually come up with a voting mechanism as well.
Rube Goldberg.
Rube Goldberg, what?
Voting mechanism.
Think that is it that we got for today. So thank you, everybody. Thank you again, Joe Dombrowski. Check him out, joe-dombrowski.com. You shout Joe Dombrowski Productions and Prime Wrestling for his stuff and over at indiewrestling.us. I'm Bobby F. J-Town. No, that's Riz. The Riz is the E-Riz. He's not. He's playing Pokemon right now, aren't you?
Not even paying attention.
He's nodding at me. He's nodding at me, audio listeners. He also has Riz Plays Games on the YouTube channel. Please go check that out. And also, Bobby F. J-Town. There he is. At Bobby F. J-Town on Twitter. He's playing Pokemon. He's letting us know how many fish are in Johnstown and everything.
Magikarps everywhere.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing? Anything you're working on? Anything coming up?
Boss Battle.
Boss Battle.
Every week. We had a show this week about Pokemon Go. Chachi was in an undisclosed location of Jacksonville, Florida. And Riz was just where he is right now.
I never move from this spot.
Yeah. We talk a lot about Pokemon Go, so go check it out on our Facebook group if you want to join that. And our Twitter account and our Insert Coin link on Facebook as well.
There you go. And, of course, Eamon Payton, Eamon 2, please, voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling. Great announcements coming up from that promotion.
Yes, our next event's August 14th, which is about a month away now. So we're announcing stuff. We just announced yesterday a Lucha Underground star that's going to be debuting for us, and somebody who's in the Cruiserweight Classic tournament that's going to be debuting for us. To get all the info, I suggest you follow us on Twitter at Inspire Pro Res, and check us out at InspireProWrestling.com.
Enjoy your time there, Eamon. You're coming to Raw, and you're going to stay there.
Well, that's the other thing. So I get to go to the gathering, watch midget wrestling next weekend, and then Raw is in Pittsburgh that Monday.
Oh, ooh, shit.
Ooh. What day is that?
It's a Monday because it's Raw.
Well, yeah.
Bobby.
But... Oh, it's the week after.
It's the week after. Yeah. It's like the 2 Mondays from now. And also, hey, guys, if you're in the Pittsburgh area, if you go to the Sorgatron Media Facebook page or look it up on themeetup.com, we have an event for a Sorgatron Media coffee. And if you want to come come with us, come join us. There's going to be free coffee from our friends Black Forge Coffee, who actually Black Forge has been representing at the IWC shows in Elizabeth for mm-hmm. a bit now. So they'll be representing in your bellies for coffee.
I do pretend to know a lot about technology.
Yes, you do. Riz hangs out. Our buddy Chilla will be there from Awesome Cast, and really it's just the time for you guys us to get together and just kind of see each other face to face, talk about the projects we're working on, and also people come out if they have ideas for podcasts or need some advice or anything like that. Come up to Work Hard Pittsburgh in the Allentown neighborhood here in Pittsburgh
this
Sunday, 1 p.m information again, the Sorgatron Media Facebook page, or look up Sorgatron Media Coffee on the meetup.com page, and come on up there. It's free. Come hang out with us. It can also be kind of a meetup if you're a Wrestling Mayhem Show fan and want to talk about some stuff, want to talk wrestling with us. That's cool too. Just want to see some people
do
there.
Some poker hunts. That's
some
fine.
Poker hunts. Uh-huh. So go check that. We hope to see you there. Don't be a stranger. Don't be a stranger.
I love you.
Hey, Riz. I love all you guys. I love you, Mayhemers. I love our chat room. I love Wheels, Tragar, Antonio Garza.
Trager's okay.
No matter how much Garza's going to hate us for these graphics. Matt Carlins. All of our Patreon supporters out there for supporting the show, making something awesome out of the Mayhem Nation and talking pro wrestling on Tuesday nights. We really appreciate it. Again, different time if you're joining us live. We won't be going live until about 10 p.m. Eastern time, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. But usually... we're broadcasting something around 8 p.m., and we start talking about wrestling shortly after that. Every week, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.